many of the techie works, but like for instance MongoDB, have you ever heard of that? Mm-hmm,
yeah.
Yeah?
So we're just starting to use that. I used to work with build a platform with Java and Python and on MySQL, and now I'm like involved in a new project where obviously not the technical part, but they're doing all the things.
Okay. So
because it's a distributed database? No. Not really.
It's actually, well, in my opinion it's not really relevant. Because you have like the technology is great, but it's a very, very specific use case where it's great.
Okay.
I'm gonna get into that. But just for you, we have sort of in a technology stack, you have a database.
Yes.
Databases are kind of annoying to work with. So on top of that you put software like authentication and all these things, user functionality, login, all that. That's all on the server. And then so the database and this is on the server. It constitutes the server side.
Yeah.
And then usually what you have is a front end.
A front end.
That lies in the client. So that's the browser. Mm-hmm. And the browser is then communicating with the server.
Okay, so when you are hiring a full stack engineer, you want to then do
it. You can do everything. Yes.
All of this stuff.
And then so then we can get into the different design patterns later. But so MongoDB. MongoDB is in the database.
In the database.
Yes. And databases.
Is it just an SQL? Or
sorry?
If it's the same data SQL, or it's something that manages.
It's not an SQL database. It's actually called a no SQL database. And the reason for that is so SQL is a relational database.
Okay.
Which means that you can have a user object. Basically, if you think of an Excel sheet, you have a lot of users in rows. And those users can then have another tab where there is orders, for instance. And there you can have a lot of orders that is related to one user.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you have this relationship between orders and users. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
I think it needs to draw if you need to. We miss a whiteboard.
Do you want to draw in here?
I have a even though I'm very technical.
Pencil.
Yeah. Yeah, but just
okay.
For you guys to understand.
Very deep.
No, it's more like I think you need to understand why, what the difference is, so that you can argue. Because you'll meet techies that are super hyped about MongoDB and want to try and use it because it's cool, but it's not really useful for most situations because of this relationship that there is between data. So NoSQL means no relation.
No
relation. You don't have any link between data points. You don't have an efficient way of retrieving data. Yes. Oh. You're going to join our chat?
Sure.
Nice.
Everybody's ready.
Yeah, it's okay. We're just going over NoSQL and SQL and the differences. But now we have the CTO of Eventbrite in the group. So then. Well, it is low tech. It's more like a decision. I want to have a discussion around the technologies that we should use for our products in the future. So why we should choose PHP or Python, or why we should never choose PHP, why we should choose Go, and this kind of things. And what are the reasons behind it? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know the answer.
No, I don't know the answer. But I wanted to talk about the pros and the cons of using the database so that you have sort of a navigational compass to begin with. And I think it would be great if we could sort of condense everything into questions that we can leave with so that we can say, I need these five questions answered, and then I can actually go out and choose the technology guys could see.
No, I have lots of questions. So this is why I really wanted to join this session because I'm
involved
in that. Exactly.
So just to finish the NoSQL and SQL discussion. With NoSQL, or with SQL, you have, say, users, right? And you have users and then maybe have orders if you have an e-commerce store.
Mm-hmm.
So you can link the users to all the orders. And you can tell the database to get me all the orders of this user.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That's in the database. So SQL, or NoSQL, you have no such thing as relation between data points. You can always look up and say, get me all the orders of the user, but you'll have to search through everything manually. And that is that's the thing. You can with NoSQL, you can efficiently store data that is dynamic. So if you have one user and you know all about his sports stuff, you can store that in there and you can retrieve it quickly. And you can have another user that where you know all about his cooking preferences, you store it in there quickly. But as soon as you have two users and you want to reference the same cooking recipe, for instance, then it becomes a problem.
And why is that?
Why? It's just because of the data structures that we use. So they're optimized for different things that are really used. Okay?
What is the best advantage of having no relationship?
So the no relationship thing is if you have completely different data that you want to store
mm-hmm.
on different users, you do that very efficiently with NoSQL because it's just one big document that's easy to retrieve. Whereas with SQL databases, you have to sort of compile the data. You have to look different places and collect it into a packet and then send it. So that's the difference. And most projects, they start out maybe without having any relationship, but then later a project can turn into a relationship thing. And then if you build it on top of a MongoDB or a NoSQL DB, you sort of have a problem, because then you have to convert all your stuff into SQL.
So
I don't know if you agree.
SQL is for relational database, so you know there's going to be a relationship between objects.
Between
objects, it's totally different tables. NoSQL is more for unstructured content. So things that you can evolve quickly without having to change the schema of the database.
Mm.
And what is a good use case for a non-relational database? It seems like data is always related.
Yeah, well, so for instance, let's say you want to store a web document. There's no real structure. Well, there is structure. But you could say that text is not really structured. So if you want to store a long article, that could be a NoSQL thing. Or if you just collect a shit ton of data on one person and you don't really know how to sort it, you can also store it in a NoSQL and just retrieve it easily.
And when you want to do something, build like an
intelligent... Yeah, both. You have one that holds the relationship between objects and then you can store a bunch of additional information in a SQL database.
Hmm.
That's what we have. So we have a MySQL relational database that has the user, and in NoSQL we have all the hits that user made to the website. So it's very optimized for writing and reading quickly in the NoSQL, because there's less constraints with MySQL Explorer.
Hmm.
But more has more integrity. You know that the relationship exists. They're structured in a way that makes it easy to retrieve.
So a use case I've heard of is that you have a system, let's say Eventbrite, and Eventbrite you can launch events, right? So a user can start his own events, and that could be the sort of use case that you start off with the minimal viable product. I just want a user to be able to broadcast his event. So then there's no real relationship to that event with anyone else. He can just throw it out there. And all the text and all the pictures and all that is not really stored. It's just a different data format every time. So we just store it on the Leo profile. But now then comes in another requirement that says we need to relate, users need to be able to subscribe to your event. Then all of a sudden it's not no relational data thing anymore, because other users need to be able to be linked to your event, and then you have a problem. So that is sort of the thing that happens with NoSQL often, that you start off with a project and it's simple and there's no relationship, but then further along you want to implement relations like a social network or social network functions, and then you have a problem because everything is not in a format.
Does it influence in a way also SEO if it's related to relation or not?
But SEO is specifically in the client.
Yeah, I was wondering if that impacts in the user experience somehow.
There is user experience in that NoSQL are very fast at loading things, if it's non-solid data. So if you have a long document with all your data and you want to show that quickly. Mm-hmm. It's very good. But if I need to collect all your likes on Facebook, for instance, on some post, then a NoSQL would be very slow at calculating that because it would have to ask the database a lot of questions. Mm-hmm. Whereas with SQL, you can ask one question.
So if you want to build something social where different users are related, Mongo doesn't make a lot of sense.
No. That it's a really bad idea.
And which
so network here, graph database is now better.
Excuse me?
Graph database.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it's made for, like, think all the relationship between the objects in 2D almost. All these users that are virtually interconnected. So it's like you're drawing a graph between all the users.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And their interests. And that's like GraphQL is something that Facebook can started because they have this problem. Mm. Interconnected nodes that need to be aware of each other and updated in real time.
Mm.
As you make an update on your post something in your newsfeed, it gets disseminated to the network. So having a way to structure the data in the database is much more efficient for this type of use case.
And do you use all three types?
We don't have a graph database because we don't have social network part that much.
Okay.
Not yet. If we were to, we would use a graph database.
And can you explain again which part do you use the non-related and which part the related one?
Relational only.
Related, yeah.
Started with just relational. I mean, the NoSQL didn't really exist when it started.
Yeah.
It's newer. We don't use it that much still. We use it to keep track of your social identities. And we could use it's any data that you think will change over time, like the structure of the data itself. So think about the Facebook API that today returns certain sets of data, and then in 2 months could return different sets of data. So with NoSQL, you don't have to care about the schema too much. You can just dump everything into the field, no matter if it matches what was there before the schema.
Okay.
So you can be more flexible in terms of what data you put into this database.
Because if the data changes, do you have to fix connections?
You can think of it as an Excel sheet. I guess you have experience with doing budgets, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you have budgets that interlink to other tabs,
yeah.
Right? And that's basically a NoSQL or SQL setup.
Yeah.
So you have like a budget line, and that sums up or takes up a number from another sheet.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say you then, I don't know, change the format of the way you do budgeting, then you have to update the whole sheet.
Yeah.
And that's SQL.
Yeah.
So if you have a data format, then you sort of have to live with that or change all your data, the way it's stored. But as like NoSQL is like Word documents, like, where you just store all everything and then you just read one document.
And if you want to build something like with natural language learning or build some automation into to whatever platform you're developing, can you actually do that with another relationship?
Yeah. So that's just the data persistency. Above that, we then have the server, right? And the server is the thing that makes sense of all the data. So the database is sort of what's saved, and then all the computation happens on the server side, and then we have the client that you're talking about. And then that was my next point. So when you came, we were talking about rapid prototyping, POP, Envision, these kind of tools where you can sort of fake an app. The question is then, now you have a concept, how do you bring it to market efficiently? And there we have the different languages that sort of allow you to do that. And you have concepts like multiple page websites. Mm-hmm. It's the typical PHP website. Every time you click on a link, get a whole new website, or you have one-page applications. That's like Facebook. Mm-hmm. You keep scrolling, you click around, and the site doesn't really update fully, mm-hmm. but you get a new window sort of automatically.
WordPress, for example, what kind of?
That is a multiple.
Multiple.
Yeah.
Is it like Angular?
Angular is one page.
One page, yeah.
Because it moves things.
Like, it doesn't change to another
site. Yeah, it doesn't reload the site, it just moves things into the site and shows things. And so, when we started our project, as you know, with Genetics, and our project, we started it in March, and we had the first sale in May. And the reason we were able to sort of develop it that fast. We developed the website in like a month without knowing anything about web development was because we chose to use a framework that allowed us to auto-generate code.
Okay,
so,
auto-generate code?
Yeah.
How?
So we have a technology like PHP.
Mm-hmm.
And PHP is very well understood because it's very old. So there's a lot of libraries out there. And typically what happens is you have a technology, PHP is a language, you can write that, but then on top of that people build technologies, and these are typically called libraries, where it's a library, like you can take a book down from a library shelf and use it, read it, or you can have frameworks that mm-hmm. sort of a complete bookshelf.
Mm-hmm.
With methodologies and things like this. Because we use a framework that's focused on, that has sort of principles, it is also able to auto-generate code, which means you can actually go from the database schematics design to an auto-generated website. And that is amazing for fast development.
Okay, but always so, in terms of prototyping, that's not for real websites.
That's for real websites. Yeah. We used that for, we still use that framework, but we used those auto-generated websites for the first launch.
And when you say auto-generated website, it's content or features or what?
So it's actually depending on the database schematics that you put out. So say again, you have a user, and a user has many orders. The framework knows that schema design and will generate a website where you can create users and create orders for that user and see the relationship.
So it creates the form that you need to enter all the
data,
basically. Okay.
Just like
so it's basically a content management system.
Then you need to make it look good,
yeah.
To
yeah.
work well, to yeah. have all the custom styling mm. makes it appear like a real website, because I imagine it's the same for
exactly.
every auto-generated code. It looks the same.
Exactly.
Customized.
How many did you have to rewrite the code before you then write
it? We had to, yeah. I mean, not entirely.
I mean, did you change?
We didn't use that, because it didn't exist.
Yeah. But from when you started, like the framework and the language and everything you used in the database structure?
The database is the same. We added more databases types the code is, there's still some that is from the back in the days, but we switched to Django in the meantime, so it's a Python framework.
Okay.
And now we're on the front end, we're switching to React now.
To what?
React, which is Facebook. It's like Angular, but I think better done.
React, but it's also a single page application.
Yeah.
I understand.
But it's whatever you want. We have a multi-page website, but now we can create also single-page type of interactions.
Okay. So the thing with these frameworks is that the front end and the back end is very tightly coupled. It's very hard to change anything because they're sort of they're bound to the way they communicate, and some of the ways that they visualize things is bound to the way the server talks, basically. So the point with this framework is that it's great for getting things out of the door. But then when you have it out of the door, it's kind of stuck because it doesn't live up to everything that you need to do. For instance, PHP doesn't do multi-threading, which is like multi-threading. So it doesn't allow you to use all the cores that you have in the system. Like, you know, today we have processes that has multiple cores. And to be able to use these, you need multi-threading, so concurrency programming. That was one of the things that I wanted to sort of remark on, that there is a trade-off you make when you choose technologies that are very fast to develop with.
Yeah.
I'm not saying it's wrong, I'm just saying that it has a, you know, you build a technology debt, it's called. You do that every time you make a bad technology decision, because you would have to clean it up later. But doubling down on super fast and efficient language in the beginning also doesn't make sense, because you don't know if your project is going to fly.
Yeah. Can I ask you a question?
Yeah, sure.
Can I? Because my question is maybe a little bit longer.
No,
go ahead. So I'm just starting with a new project. I have worked with a tech team and we developed an app. First version was in PHP, then we rewrote everything in Django and with MySQL. And now I'm joining, so we now met this other company. We're merging both companies and we're developing recipe management software. So it's basically, you know, HubSpot. So they have like inbound marketing, and then they have like the HubSpot software, and then they offer this service to implement this software either through their own consultancy or through an agency network. So this is a restaurant consultancy. They use their technology to implement their method to run a profitable and successful restaurant. And what they, because it's in a sector that is not very digital, and they have this method. It's basically like an IKEA toolbox. You do this, and that, and then they use like agile principles of constant improvement, feeding that feedback into the system to constantly improve. So they will not use our technology. They have built their own, and they use basically everything that you just said. Like they use a non-relational database, everything is in Angular, and it's the opposite of what we did before, that was in Django and in MySQL. Mm-hmm. Because what is happening here, we have a public part that basically chefs can use to create their own database of recipes, and then there is a private part where you actually have to pay and you get all the benefits of to manage a restaurant. So it connects to the POS and to the supplier side, and it helps you optimize your recipes. So my question basically is, if we want to build something where, so right now every user has their own database, but what we want is that there is a common database of recipes and of content that is public and that is shared, and also all the libraries. Right now we have to upload libraries for every client, but we want that they are shared among among all clients, so that they can actually co-create this database of libraries as a like a wiki.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering if they built it on this non-relational database, if this actually is feasible to do it.
Hmm. It's very hard to answer that question without seeing the data, but like a rule of thumb is that if you want people to be on the same data, like a user having access to the same recipes, for instance, or say that you have several recipes and they all use tomato, it might make sense to have the concept of a tomato in one place, instead of having three copies of the same concept. And so as soon as you have a recipe, say you have several recipes, and they use tomato, zucchini, meat, lamb, 50 gram, whatever, then it becomes relational, and then NoSQL is not a good idea. But I don't know exactly what they use the NoSQL for. And NoSQL is not a problem in small scale, but NoSQL becomes a problem when you have thousands, millions of entries that needs to search, you need to search through.
When you don't have enough data, it doesn't matter.
No.
What is much or not much data?
So if you have a low check
number, it's not much data.
It's not much data.
So I don't think for recipes, it's going to matter too much. You're not going to have hundreds of millions of recipes.
But there's a development time thing as well, right? Because you have to.
Yeah, NoSQL is probably faster.
It's faster, that's what I think.
Even structured data, and you just dump whatever you want, and you do search and still search is pretty
good. But you have to write away search queries, right? Like manually.
No, you return all the records that have tomato in them.
Okay.
It just doesn't know what tomato is, it just searches. And you might run into spelling problems. Mm. Tomato is with a no, and tomato is with a no.
Yeah.
Tomato.
My question is related to this in terms my concern is about the obsolescence of the technologies in terms of now it's a hype with this mango or whatever you start developing a region with this in 3 years there is a new thing that they supposed to have some advantages and is there a risk that all you have developed now is obsolete because there is something new very fast. Or is adaptable to everything, or you have to rewrite everything each time a new technology comes out?
No. Well, of course, there's a lot of technologies out there that are being hacked, and that's one of the dangers. I think, of course, you have to go with a technology that you know is well supported, like React, for instance. It's React and Angular that we've been talking about. React is owned and supported and used by Facebook.
Okay.
And Angular is owned and supported and used by Google.
So finally you have to look at who is after the technologies.
Who is building these and
who's maintaining
it's
all okay. Improving it
and then it's not going to stop.
And then you have to ask yourself, well, what is it that I want with my technology, right? So, do I want to have a mobile app, for instance, or do I want to be purely on web?
Okay.
That's a question that you have to answer yourself, because if you want to be purely on web...
So you want both? Because nowadays, I think everybody wants to have application or...
They want to have a similar front ends. Then you have to choose technologies that support that easily, right? And React, for instance, is a very, very good decision to go with in this case because it's a web page app. And it also has a library that's called React Native, where you can write with the same code, write iOS apps and Android apps.
And that is
which
one?
Android. No, that's React.
React.
Yeah.
And this is for an interface on the screen.
So that's for web and for iOS apps. So it's you write code in. So React is what's. It's a JavaScript framework. Mm-hmm. So JavaScript is the technology, mm-hmm. and React is the framework. And you can write JavaScript code, React code, and that will then be translated into iOS code, mm-hmm. and you can then have it on your phone, like a normal app. And the same with the Android.
And what is the difference between JavaScript and Python?
That's a big question.
No, because the way I have understood it is there is PHP, Python, and Ruby on Rails. But is it like this?
Yeah, yes. That's some of the services.
So you basically you decide what you use, and then JavaScript is it's front end. Okay.
Can also be backend. With Node.
Yeah.
But
and if you want to build an interface, or if you want to build in voice recognition and other type of commands, it doesn't have anything to do with the language that you're using.
Or you can do it in you can do it in PHP. It will be very hard to do natural language processing.
But would you use an API
with
the code of anything existing?
Yeah, definitely using language.
So that's
even JavaScript on the front end to call an API directly and do something with the results.
That's one of the reasons why you would use Python, like Django, because Python has so many libraries that would support these kind of things. So that you can take off the shelf.
Because one of the main problems with chefs is that, or why there is no technology in kitchens. The first thing is the technology that exists is really old, and it's basically horrible Excel 95 kind of spreadsheets that I hate to use. And then also because screens in kitchens are really not handy. So the trend really is to go into language control devices or.
But I don't think language processing is field-centric. So I don't know how you work in a kitchen where you're very specialized words for a lot of things, like tools they use. I don't know if a library exists to be able to recognize all these very specific kitchen-centric words.
Yeah. So to make a voice recognition before you have to create a library with all the words to be recognized, then it's kind of database based of
You can limit the vocabulary of voice recognition licenses to be specific.
So for this case, before creating the application for voice recognition, maybe someone has to create a specific kitchen language.
It depends. I think it's specific for defined, it's special for detailed instructions.
We are also talking about something really super basic, like kitchens is dictate a recipe, you can probably use any
Process
system.
You have to say.
You have to test it.
How would you go about having something
it's
like that?
It's definitely not minimal viable products. Like voice recognition is definitely an add-on that you put on later, I would say.
Because with WhatsApp now it's easy to.
You can try with Siri.
Yeah.
And you transcribe say what you want to say as a recipe.
Because this morning somebody explained to us that they were building something with Alexa. And they just
used. Yeah, I guess they have APIs that they can use, but. That's a whole business in itself.
Alexa can understand basic information like the ingredients, but the language is more complex, like sofre, cortar y which are specific kitchen commands that are not a common language.
But you have to build a
I think that's definitely you can get API integrations where you can do that, but you also have to pay for
it. We use one to do the conversions and to calculate nutritional value and allergens, diets, their IHRs.
I'm sure the chemical components will not be recognized.
Yeah, I also think that it's very, like a kitchen environment is very nice. If you try to do Siri right now, it's going to be extremely hard to actually get to recognize. Anyway, with regards to React, I just wanted to make sure that you guys understand the difference between having the JavaScript compiled to languages. So normally what you would do is you need to write code for the iPhone specific. You need to write code for Android specific. And then you have to write code for the web. What React allows us to do is use one language and one code base for everything.
That's very useful in terms of effectiveness of
very useful. And for maintenance especially. Yes. And one last thing I would like to touch upon is that code is read more than it's written. And if you get a bigger team, it's especially important. Right now, I've written all my code, and I understand everything that I've done. But when you get a big team, like 150 engineers that are trying to work together, you have a lot of different guys that have to understand the same thing. And that's why you need to choose technologies that are expressed simply. A good example of that is Python is very easy to read, but also something like Google Go, which is maintained by Google, is developed for that single purpose, that it should be easier to read and maintain than actually to write.
How are you, sir? I only need to go
through. You need training and documentation, best practices. Examples, trainings, and co-creation. We use a lot of footages so we can help each other.
How do you organize the work?
Post the change and then other people can comment on it. Look at my program. Right, it shares the actual request.
And how many teams are there divided here in the background?
18 teams. About 5 people.
And how do you make sure that they are consistent among each other and what they need?
Tell them what to expect and hope that they will correct each other. There's no way to enforce anything except reviewing code. So when someone writes something that's not the way we expected, then you have to have someone else to tell them. So it's knowing where the rules are, having enough eyes on every code change, you can slowly train people as to what the best way to do something is. That takes time.
And how many product managers do you have for each
developer? Half or one. Sometimes, yeah, like 2 or 3 teams.
And do you have somebody overseeing all product managers?
Yeah. We have a VP product, director of product. So it's VP, director, manager, same manager.
So the product manager talks to the VP or talks directly to the developer?
Talks to the developer. The team is PM plus engineers plus designer.
Curious, no, I've been talking about and I've been trying to give you some insights into how things work. But where do you see the things moving
In terms of
front-end technologies in terms of general?
I think just the need for web and mobile, the React Native and React will have to come in for sure. Microservices will probably come in.
What's that?
Microservices or services in general. So instead of returning HTML to the client, you return some data structure, JSON or XML, but in the content technology that you use, and then render so that you can change React to render if you want to, without rewriting the backend. The interaction with the data store remains the same, no matter what the front end is. So you can be more agile with what technologies you use, if you use different technologies for each service. If you think Go is more efficient for certain things, you use Go for that service, and most Python because it's better machine learning libraries.
So the microservices are what connects both sides, or?
Oh, you can see if you take a look at this model here. This is a microinsystem. System. So it's a monolith, it's called, because everything is contained in one thing.
Yes, you like that.
And I see the other good service. And in here we have orders. I deal with orders. I deal with the users. I deal with genetics. But it's all the same system, right? So the bigger this system becomes, that's what you see in big enterprises. They have these huge monolithic systems, and nobody dares touch them because then something breaks and they lose them.
That's how we started off.
Because the engineers have long retired and. And they use old languages like COBOL or something. So an alternative to this, so the communication still goes between orders and users and genetics, but inside the system. And an alternative to this is that you have sort of blobs around that handles different things. So this could, for instance, be the order blob, and then the user blob, and then you have some sort of aggregation service that sends stuff to the front end. But you have communication between different servers, and your servers can be located in different places. It's very great, as you said, because there are two main advantages. With this, everything lies on the same server, which means that you have to scale up the same server, even though you don't use maybe the order interface that often as the genetics interface. So they all have to lie on the same CPU and take the same power. So that's one key advantage. Over here you can have different systems that support different servers. The other thing is that you have you can much easier trash the order system and build a new one, as long as you maintain the same method of communication to your other servers. So then when you move from a monolithic structure to a microservice structure, the communication becomes key. And that's really what you have to do.
You can use different data stores for each service.
Yeah.
So if you want to see for this and see for that.
And here, in the monolithic, there's like one big database that happens.
It's not separated, so you don't know it's just belongs to web. So it's really hard to upgrade just one piece in the monolithic.
One thing though is that with this, you sort of know when something pops up, and it will pop up. You know, okay, if the monolith, that's something wrong with. But if you have a communication that goes from here to users, to orders, back to users, goes over here, and then finally there, then you have to be very good at knowing, tracking what happens to know exactly where the error happened. So we use good model complexity.
Inter-service monitoring, discovery, versioning, a lot of complexity
services. So Netflix, for instance, they're running on 200, I think, different microservices.
Uber has
1500.
Do you call it microservice or like a server?
Microservice.
Service.
Yeah. So there's a huge overhead in maintaining the communication and knowing what goes wrong where, and if you upgrade one piece, one service, then all the other services that are dependent on that service then has a problem and also needs to be updated, so you need to know what you want to do there. But there's a lot of different, like, for instance, in Teams, if you have an ambitious software engineer and he wants to show that he is the boss, then you can say, okay, you take charge of the user service. Then when if he's hungry, you can also say, okay, you also have the order service and you control everything. And then later, sort of give him a team. If he continues to be. So yeah. I think that's actually the talk, but
Thank you so much.